are looking at right now, a lot of moisture moving up from the Pacific. And if you can think of it as a faucet, the faucet is still on, if not increasing. When is this faucet ever going to shut down? Well, maybe tomorrow. We are looking for snow levels to drop maybe by tonight down to lake level by tomorrow morning. If that's the case, that will be some good news. We'll start to see a lot of the rain turn to snow. But for today, for the next at least 18 hours, heavy rains, and they seem to be increasing intensity over the last couple of hours. Here is radar out of Sacramento. You can see that, and we have to look farther since it's a southwest flow. This is the area. This is a critical area for us right now, because in the Bay Area or south of the Bay Area, this is where we can see our moisture coming from. And you can see how rain pretty much takes over all the way from the Bay Area up to the Sierra. And notice these yellows. This represents kind of the mid-level of this range right here of intensity. And that tells us right now that we are expecting heavy rains to move back into the mountains through this morning hours. And that does not mean good news for us, because that only just sends more water down these rivers. At this particular time, we are still looking for rain. If you think about it, as the way this span looks right now, at least for the next 6 hours, and at this time, we're not sure if we're going to shut that off. We think we're going to probably see rain pretty much through the day period, and then hopefully tonight, tomorrow morning, that is when we are hoping to see some breaks. Here is your forecast. Look for rain up in the mountains. Snow level very high at this time, about 9,000 feet, maybe down to 7,500 feet by late day, and maybe below lake level by tomorrow morning. A high wind warning for Tahoe and Reno. Southwest winds gusting up to 80 miles per hour in Tahoe, gusts up to 50 miles per hour here in Reno. Now, of course, this is a very difficult situation because we don't have a whole lot to look back on as to how soon the rivers will recede once the rain stops. But at this particular time, if we're looking for maybe the rain to stop sometime tomorrow, maybe tomorrow morning, we could see at least more flooding, or at least a good 24 to 48 hour period at least of seeing these river waters receding. So it's going to be a tough next 24 hours, Jennifer, and we hope you all can just hang in there and continue to bring you vital information.
The bridge here on Highway 88 was closed due to debris pileup and erosion. lot of debris going over 395 right now. River's crossing the highway here heading east. On 395, here's where the water goes under the Cradle Ball Bridge here. People got off the county shuttle at the Lutheran Bridge and walked across to a National Guard truck to be taken to the Tillman Center. The shuttle truck arrangement was the only way into the ranchos as bridges and roads were cut off during the flood.
Here's where the road ends and the river begins. I've been instructed to make this fast. We got to get back over the bridge in case it crumbled. So I'm going to get back over.
Start of Kingsbury Grade are closed this morning. That includes Centerville Lane, Mottsville Lane, Muller Lane, and Genoa Lane. Foothill Road is also now closed. Other road closures include Waterloo Lane through Lampy Park, Tillman to the Dressler Ranch, the Power Dam Road, China Springs Road, Reese Road, and Penrod Lane. Also, Highway 50 over Echo Summit is closed this morning, and a major portion of Highway 88 through the valley is closed from the junction of 395 to Fairview Lane. So far, the Riverview Trailer Park, the Aspen Mobile Home Park, the 5th Green Court Area, and King Lane Mobile Home Park have all been evacuated, and also Westwood Village has been evacuated. The evacuation center has been set up at the Carson Valley Middle School. School has also been canceled today for all Douglas County schools, including schools in the Carson Valley and up at Lake Tahoe. Now, the East Fork of the Carson River is causing big concerns for residents of the Carson Valley this morning. This video we will show you was shot last night near the Riverview Trailer Park at the south end of the valley. Residents there have been evacuated due to rising waters and the threat that the old power dam could collapse there. Now, they're very concerned about that the river has eroded to the mountainside to the left, and our officials are worried that the large block of concrete could collapse and release water and sediment. Now, the Carson River is currently flowing at 12,800 cubic feet per second. That's more than 2 feet above the official flood stage of 8 feet.
To get a good idea on how much erosion has occurred during the flood, here's what the power dam looked like a few years before. Compare this to this, and you can see a dramatic difference. Once the river passes the power dam, it's here at the Riverview Trailer Park where it must turn. Tractor operators work through the day and night trying to keep the floodwaters from taking the trailer park. Dirt was brought in and spread out. The flood of 97 had its first fatality. At around 5:30 p.m. on January 2nd, Fred Pinard of Gardnerville was operating his front end loader trying to save these trailers when the riverbank he was on simply gave way. The tractor rolled into the raging river and disappeared. Two Army National Guard helicopters spent the better part of the evening searching by air. On the ground, firefighters watched. But by 8 o'clock that evening, facing very dangerous conditions, the search was called off, calling it a lost cause. Here we're coming up to the Riverview Bridge. Notice the amount of erosion that has occurred on the bridge approach. And here's a view from the ground showing the erosion on the bridge. Here we are back in the air again, and we're now heading north along the Carson River. Here's the Lutheran Bridge. Officials had determined the bridge was safe to cross, so it was open. This would be the only way in and out of the ranchos until the other bridges could be repaired. Here we come upon the bridge at Highway 88. This bridge sustained the same kind of damage as the Riverview Bridge, but more severe. And here's a view from the ground showing the erosion on the bridge.
And of course, we've got a massive amount of debris here. How the water eroded through here. Here's the asphalt from the street. Probably got about 4 feet there of overhang.
This used to be the parking lot at TCI Cable. It's now part of the Carson River. This was the garage for the cable company. Cable service was out in Carson Valley because TCI lost some of its satellite dishes to the river. It wasn't long before partial cable service was restored to Carson Valley using temporary equipment. During the flood on January 2nd, these tractor operators were doing their best to prevent the river from taking the Riverview Trailer Park. Compare this view to this view, which was filmed the next day on January 3rd, and you'll see just how much land was lost. Here's a closer view of that trailer. What was once a yard and road is now a rapid. And here's a devil's eye view of the trailer foundation. Sadly, this is where a Gardnerville construction worker lost his life in trying to stabilize a dirt bank. His front end loader rolled over into the water when the bank gave way.
We talked about we were seeing some of the damage here, and we see it firsthand, but a lot of the areas we haven't been able to get to, like Gardnerville. Explain some of the things that you were seeing down there as far as like houses that are just totally submerged.
Well, we had a dam break in Gardnerville, and the water cascaded through. There's a golf course in Gardnerville, and the houses that are on that are virtually submerged. I mean, they're in several feet of water in these houses, maybe halfway up the house, in fact, in some instances. Their damage is going to be astronomical, and the water river there is spread on both sides. It's running kind of rampant. It's eroding the soil nearby. It's a real risk within that whole area. And then it runs on down through into the valley, and the west side of the valley, where Genoa is, for example, is like a huge lake. In fact, Genoa Lakes Golf Course, that many people are probably familiar with, is completely submerged, and the housing around there. A lot of it is underwater already. There's a couple that are maybe elevated a little in their ground, but they're still going to be getting some damage in there. That whole area, almost two-thirds of the way from the mountain out to the highway, is one big lake.
come on fairway, and we just passed Eagle.
Residents who lived near the golf course were evacuated with the help of the Douglas County Sheriff's Department. Anyone who needed to get items from their flooded homes were escorted in and out of the area by sheriff's personnel.
Their driveway is, it's under about 2 feet of rock and mud right now.
clear back to the back of the garage back there.
Incredible.
You can see the water line inside. I was in this house today. It looks just like that inside the house.
Oh, my God.
We must have at least 3 feet of mud in here.
Major amounts of debris in here, 3 to 4 feet of mud. Incredible.
About, what's that,
18, 2 feet
all down there.
Well, from outside, it's...
Can I help you? Jeannie, those plastic bags in the washroom? Huh? Oh, okay.
I've got Mom's oxygen equipment. That's...
What? That wooden floor under there makes it pretty slick.
Show you the how high the river was here on Riverview. There is the water line. Seems to be about three and a half, 4 feet maybe above the ground here. And you can see the line right along the house. I'm at the Country Club restaurant. A lot of water, a lot of mud.
It's January 3rd, and with only the Lutheran Bridge open, the 10,000 residents of the Ranchos had only one way in and out of the area. This created a traffic nightmare, especially during the rush hour commute. In the coming days, Carson Valley will have a chance to dry out. Here's what this house looked like during the flood and after the flood. Homeowners would now start a massive cleanup. The Federal Emergency Management Agency, or FEMA, would be setting up a command post. It's amazing how much mud will have to be removed from these homes. Here a backhoe tractor gets bogged down in this sticky stuff. It's hard to imagine the power of water, and that this house looked like this just a few days before. As seen here on Muller, the raging, swirling waters carry uprooted trees, brush, and logs from the mountains. piling up masses of debris behind dams and bridges, causing the pressure of the water to wash them out, or, if they hold, forcing it to spread silt-laden blankets over fields and pastures. Too often, the rushing waters carry gravel and boulders, destroying land wherever they come to rest. Here's what the Riverview Bridge looked like after the flood. And here's what it looked like after it was repaired. Large rocks were placed along the bridge approach in the attempt to reduce erosion during our next flood. The kind of damage that occurred on the Riverview Bridge also occurred here on the Highway 88 bridge, the erosion of the bridge approach itself. Except for the foundations, these bridges made it through the flood in pretty good shape. Here's what the bridge looked like on January 3rd. And here's what it looked like by January 10th. Like the Riverview Bridge, rocks were placed along the bridge approach. Assemblyman Lynn Hedrick said everywhere he's gone in the past few days, people have commented on how well Douglas County and the state responded to the flooding and its aftermath. The New Year's flood of 1997 taught us many lessons. We learned that the river can go from tranquil to torrent in a very short matter of time. We learned that the Carson River has a mind of its own. We learned that every time there is a disaster, we come together as a community. We learned what a difference planning can make, and that along with the river, We can rise to the occasion, too.